eyes. We follow the liturgy printed in the bulletin. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will go to the altar of God. To God, my exceeding joy. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
You may be seated. During this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to intensify our struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that prevents us from trusting in God and loving each other. Since it is our intention to receive the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ, on this night when he instituted this blessed meal for our salvation, it is proper that we complete our Lenten discipline by diligently examining ourselves, as St. Paul urges us to do. This holy sacrament has been instituted for the special comfort of those who are troubled because of their sins, and who humbly confess their sins, fear God's wrath, and hunger and thirst for righteousness. When we examine our hearts and consciences, we find nothing in us but sin and death, from which we are incapable of delivering ourselves. Therefore, our Lord Jesus Christ has had mercy on us. For our benefit, he became man so that he might fulfill for us the whole will and law of God, and to deliver us took upon himself our sin and the punishment we deserve. So that we may more confidently believe this and be strengthened in the faith and in holy living, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you." It is as if he said, "I became man, and all that I do and suffer is for your good. As a pledge of this, I give you my body to eat." In the same way also, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins." Again, it is as if he said, "I have had mercy on you by taking into myself all your iniquities. I give myself into death, shedding my blood to obtain grace and forgiveness of sins, and to comfort and establish the New Testament, which gives forgiveness and everlasting salvation. As a pledge of this, I give you my blood to drink." Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup, confidently believing this word and promise of Christ, dwells in Christ and Christ in him, and has eternal life. We should also do this in remembrance of him, showing his death that he was delivered for our offenses and raised for our justification. Giving him our most heartfelt thanks, we take up our cross and follow him and, according to his commandments, love one another as he has loved us. For we are all one bread and one body, even as we are all partakers of this one bread and drink from the one cup. For just as the one cup is filled with the wine of many grapes and one bread made from countless grains, so also we, being many, are one body in Christ. Because of him we love one another, not only in word, but in deed and in truth. May the almighty and merciful God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by his Holy Spirit, accomplish this in us.
Amen.
Having heard the word of God, let us confess our sins, imploring God our Father, for the sake of his Son, Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness. Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, the poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you for your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the Holy
God be merciful to you and strengthen your faith.
Amen.
You believe that the forgiveness I seek is not my forgiveness, but God's?
Yes.
Let it be done for you as you believe. In the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it. Go in peace.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord, in this wondrous sacrament, you have left us a remembrance of your passion. Grant that we may so receive the sacred mystery of your body and blood, that the fruits of your redemption may continually be manifest in us. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. In those days, Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the rules. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he threw against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, "All that the Lord has spoken we will do, and we will be obedient." And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered.
The Lord is gracious and merciful.
He provides food for those who fear him.
He remembers his covenant forever.
Brethren, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered.
The Lord is gracious and merciful.
He provides food for those who fear him.
He remembers his covenant forever.
My flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink.
Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him.
At that time, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, when the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going back to God, rose from supper. He laid aside his outer garments, and taking a towel, tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but afterward you will understand." Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "The one who is bathed does not need to wash except for his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not every one of you." For he knew who was to betray him. That is why he said, "Not all of you are clean." When he had washed their feet and put on his outer garments and resumed his place, he said to them, "Do you understand what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If then your Lord and teacher has washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that you also should do just as I have done to you." You may be seated. We'll sing hymn 640 to the tune of "Abide with Me." instituted on this night. There is no one name it goes by. There is a beauty in calling it by different names at different times. Just as no one here has a single name or title that captures everything about them. At times I'm Jacob, at times I'm pastor, sometimes son, sometimes father. So too, there is no one word or one title that captures everything that is contained in the bread and wine that sits atop our altar. In the book of Acts, it's simply called the fellowship of the breaking of the bread. The ancient church called it the liturgy of the faithful or the mass of the faithful, depending on what language you spoke. After the service of the word or the liturgy of the catechumens, all who were not yet instructed in the faith would leave the church, and the sacred meal would be celebrated only by baptized, instructed, communing Christians. With this title, we recall that only those who are worthy are to receive this holy meal. Later Christians would call this Eucharist, which simply means thanksgiving. With this title, we recall that our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, gave thanks. St. Paul, in writing to the church in Corinth, called this holy meal the Lord's Supper, reminding us that it is indeed a real eating and a real drinking. It is a true supper, just as our Lord in human flesh really ate and drank on that Thursday evening so many years ago. So also calling it the Lord's Supper reminds us that that which we feast on is the body and blood of our Lord. Perhaps most familiar among us is the title communion. And this has the same root word as community or even communism, things that are held in common. This title reminds us that when we approach the railing, we are not doing so as individuals with our own beliefs or opinions about what's going on in the supper, but we are coming together with a common faith. We are one body in Christ, one community, one communion in Christ. Indeed, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a communion in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a communion in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, said, "Take and eat all of you, take and drink all of you. This body is broken for you. This blood is shed for you." And these words, "for you," require all hearts to believe. For you requires a communion, a community. Martin Luther, in the Small Catechism, simply calls it the sacrament of the altar, reminding us both that this is a holy mystery instituted by God and that it is to remind us of a sacrifice. And this is indeed the very same body that will be broken on the cross tomorrow for your sins. This is the same blood that will flow from the Lord's side for the remission of your blood guiltiness. In our liturgy, in some of our hymns and prayers, we call this a foretaste of the feast to come. And perhaps on this, the night when our Lord was betrayed, it is the most fitting title. Jesus tells us, after he blesses the cup, that he will not drink of the fruit of the vine until he drinks it anew in his Father's kingdom. And whether that means not until Easter or not until the resurrection of all the dead doesn't really matter. What matters is that this meal is established as something that anticipates the future. A blessed future for all of us. Where there will be no more COVID, no more oxygen machines, no more war, no more politics. But a blessed future where every tear will be wiped away. There will be no more mourning or crying or pain. Our Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, established this meal so that when we eat and drink the bread and wine, and in doing so eat and drink the very body and blood of our Lord, we are drawn into eternity, that we catch a glimpse of what life is like on the other side of glory. So also, as only God can do, not only does he draw us into the future, but who calls us to remember the past, that we do this in remembrance of him. So that when we drink the wine and eat the bread, when we eat his body and drink his blood, we recall his cross and passion. We recall all that he has done for us. When we gather together on the Lord's Day for this blessed sacrament, it's easy to remember Easter. And indeed, every Sunday is a miniature Easter. It's easy to sing joyful songs of praise, and it's meet, right, and salutary so to do. But tonight, we gather in the upper room, knowing that in just a few hours, the Lord will be betrayed, arrested, beaten, and scourged. He will be hanged on a cross. The disciples will scatter. But we will be found faithful and remain with Mary and John sitting at the foot of our Lord's cross. Tonight we sit in quiet meditation as we hear our Lord establish the new covenant in his blood, his final testament for your salvation. So let us celebrate this memorial meal. Let us partake of the sacrament of the altar and eat God's final sacrifice for us. Let us partake of the Eucharist and give thanks to the Son for what he accomplished for us on the cross. Let us take the Lord's Supper and in doing so eat his body and drink his blood so that we may find real bodily union with him. Let us together participate in this communion, that our fellowship with one another would be made manifest to the world around us. Let us, for a moment, step out of time and space and enter into eternity, that having experienced the foretaste of the feast to come, we would dry our tears and faithfully follow our Lord as he takes up his cross tomorrow. Let us return daily to the beautiful union that he gives us in this holy meal, so that when we follow him into the grave, we do so knowing that we will follow Jesus right out of it again. In his holy name. We collect our tithes and gifts. God the Father, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, O God the Son, given to be head over the church, O God the Holy Spirit, love of the Father and the Son, O Holy Trinity, eternal love, have mercy upon us. by your ministry of healing and forgiveness, by your seeking and saving the lost, by your words of eternal life, Lord, in your mercy, by your calling and training of the 12 apostles, by your promise to build your church, by your institution of the Holy Sacrament, Lord, in your mercy, by the love shown in your crucifixion, by the power of your resurrection, by the glory of your ascension, and by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, Lord, in your mercy, that it may please you to strengthen and enlarge your holy church in every land, and to unite all those who profess and call themselves Christians in faith, hope, and charity, Lord, in your mercy, that it may please you to bless our synod and grant repentance unto those within her who have fallen into error, and especially give guidance to our elected leaders, Matthew and John, that we might be preserved steadfast in your word, Lord, in your mercy, that your church may strive not for its own safety, but for the world's salvation, seeking only your kingdom and your righteousness, Lord, in your mercy, by your establishment and preservation of all the nations of the earth, and that our President Joseph might be preserved in safety and guided in wisdom, Lord, in your mercy, that your church may proclaim the gospel throughout the whole world and make disciples of all nations, Lord, in your mercy, that you would grant to all ministers of your word and sacraments the spirit of wisdom, power, and love, and call many more to the work of your ministry, Lord, in your mercy, that you would give to all your people grace to understand and to believe your word, and to show forth their faith in their lives, Lord, in your mercy. That we may reverently and rightly use your sacraments and be strengthened in body and soul by your heavenly grace, Lord, in your mercy. That you would remove from us all hatred, prejudice, and narrowness of thought, that we may receive and rejoice in all that you have revealed, Lord, in your mercy. That you would guide us in all perplexities of belief and conduct, that we may hold fast that which is true and faithfully confess you before men, Lord, in your mercy. That regardless of the praise or contempt of the world, your church may worship and adore you in spirit and in truth, Lord, in your mercy. And as we pray for the church universal, so let us pray for God's blessing on the church in this place. Here may the faithful find salvation and the careless be awakened, Lord, in your mercy. Here may the doubting find faith and the anxious be encouraged, Lord, in your mercy. Here may the tempted find help and the sorrowful comfort, Lord, in your mercy. Here may the weary find rest and the strong be renewed, Lord, in your mercy. Here may the aged find consolation and the young be inspired, Lord, in your mercy. Remembering your steadfast love, all of your people, the sick, the downtrodden, the depressed, the anxious, the lonely, all women with children, all those who long for such a blessing, those who are poor, those who are imprisoned, and the widow, the orphan, and the sojourner in our midst. Lord, in your mercy, we ask for a special portion of your grace upon those who are unable to join the church in public worship, especially Candy, Birdie, Olive, Lavera, Marion, Jackie, Nan, Charles and Mary, Loretta, and Lily. Lord, in your mercy. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to do far more abundantly than we ask or think, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the day before he offered himself for us upon the altar of the cross, poured out for all mankind the richness of his love and mercy, and from the treasury of his heart brought forth the mystery of the Eucharist, wherein the faith of them that believe is nourished, their hope increased, their love made strong, and a pledge of future glory is received. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of Saturday, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
God, who has refreshed us with this salutary gift, grant, we pray, that what we pursue in time of mortality, we may attain by your gift of immortality. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the body which shall be delivered for you. This is the cup of the New Testament in my blood, saith the Lord. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my glory? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded. But I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lips, they shake the head, saying, he trusted in the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, being he delighted in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Many bows have compassed me, strongholds of the sun have beset me round. They gaze upon me with their mouths, as a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me, they pierced my hands and feet. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon not thou far from me, O Lord. O my strength, haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorn. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him. All ye the seed of Jacob, glorify him, and fear him, all ye the seed of Israel. For he hath not despised nor bore the affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him, but when he cried unto him, he heard. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that seek him. Your heart shall live forever. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord. And all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. For the kingdom is the Lord, and he is the governor among the nations. And they that be sat upon the earth shall eat and worship. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. A seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. This is the body which shall be delivered for you. This is the cup of the New Testament in my blood, saith the Lord. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.